Good evening, everyone. I'll call the special meeting of the Board of Education to order. We'll stand and be led in the pledge by Mr. Lewis.
Aye.
I allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please remain standing. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lewis. Can I have roll call, please?
Mr. Levinson?
Here.
Mr. Lewis?
Here.
Mrs. McAfee?
Here.
Mr. Cartlett?
Here.
Ms. Rath? Mr. Bensley?
Present.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Mr. Check?
Here. Our first item on the agenda is from the superintendent.
Thank you, Madam President. Gives me great pleasure tonight to announce the resolution to approve the appointment of the executive high school principal.
Can I have a motion?
So moved. Second.
Questions or comments? Roll call, please.
Mr. Levinson?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Mrs. McAfee?
Yes.
Mr. Cartlett?
Yes.
Mr. Bensley?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Mr. Check?
Yes.
I'd like to read the resolution. Resolution number 030512A. Be it resolved that upon the recommendation of the superintendent of schools, the Board of Education of the Newburgh and Large City School District hereby appoints Maxine O'Dell to the position of executive high school principal at the Newburgh Free Academy to serve a 3-year probationary term in the executive high school principal tenure area, effective July 1st, 2012 through June 30th, 2015, at an annual salary of $155,000 as per the Newburgh Supervisors and Administrators Associate Agreement, replacing Peter Kobolay. I'd like Mr. O'Dell to stand up, please, for the crowd. Welcome to Newburgh.
I have a motion to adjourn the special meeting of the board.
So moved.
Roll call, please.
Levinson?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
McAfee?
Yes.
Mr. Cartlett?
Yes.
Mr. Bensley?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Mr. Check?
Yes. At this time, we will begin our budget workshop this evening. The budget workshop is for the purpose of the board for discussion. Any items that you hear this evening will be available for your comment at the next public board meeting, which is March 27th. Yes, Tuesday, March 27th. There will be no interaction with the board or central office staff with any members of the audience. Mr. Pizzo?
Thank you, Madam President.
Thank you, Madam President. You'll have to bear with us tonight. As you people know, we don't usually use this room, but we anticipate a larger crowd than we can handle at the board office, so that's why we're here. So our electronics may not work as well as you can hear, as they usually do. So bear with us, please. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to our first budget meeting of the year. This is the third year we have faced with a large budget gap. This year, the gap is $15.2 million to stay under the mandated state 2% tax cap. Senior staff, with the input from building administrators and directors from all levels, have developed a budget which has maintained the basic integrity of programs throughout the district. But in times of tight money, we cannot do business as usual. We must change the paradigm more as much with less. We are forced to do less with less. And this is the third year in a row of tight money. With these very tight monetary parameters, I am proposing a budget for the Board of Ed to discuss tonight in hopes that we jointly arrive at the 2.63% mandated tax cap to offer the hard-pressed taxpayers of the Newburgh and Large City District. I will now turn the meeting over to Mr. Pacella. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Pizzo. For those of you that weren't at the last presentation on that we did for the board and the public, I'm just going to go briefly through the PowerPoint, which can be found on the website. It's some clarifications of that tax cap law. It shows the financial position of the district now, where we have to get in terms of the cap, and what the governor has proposed for Newburgh to receive an aid. What needs to be realized is that the cap is not absolute. Budgets can exceed the cap if approved by at least 60% of the voters that actually vote. The cap will seldom be exactly 2%. As Mr. Pizzo had mentioned, our cap with all the exclusions is 2.63%. And if the simple majority of the voters will have the power to block any tax increase that will go over that. If the vote is defeated twice, the districts must freeze the levy, which makes the cuts much more severe. So taking the 2.63% on top of the current levy of $97.5 million, the district can only raise $2,569,000 in taxes, 2.63%, which only equates to a 1.17% increase on our total budget. Our total budget is $218 million. For this reason, the new legislative cap by the governor and endorsed by legislators is unfair for our district, which is a low wealth, high need. So what does this picture look like for us, for Newburgh? Well, the governor placed an additional $800 million into the state budget for education, and he promised that highest need districts will benefit. And by the way, the federal jobs fund allocation that saved over 30 jobs last year is being taken away by the federal government. It's $3,049,000. So the general fund will have to absorb an additional 25 to 30 positions. Our aid picture is such that we only received an additional $483,000 in aid from the current year. With that $3 million being lost, the net change in aid to the Newburgh School District is a minus $2.6 million, almost equivalent to the tax levy that we can increase. So the preliminary 2012-2013 budget, with the estimations of the rollover of the Triborough Agreement, our contracts, our benefits that go along with them, coupled with the local revenue and the aid that we can receive, the taxes that needed to support the budget amount to about $113.8 million. We can only raise $100 million. We just had a recent revised estimate for insurance, which increased that number by $1.9 million. So our true, actual, preliminary budget gap is $15.6 million. And that's what the board is charged to do. Come up with $15.6 million to get under the legal mandated cap. So what you have here, and just to recap again what Mr. Pizzo said, over the past 2 years, in 2010-2011, the board reduced the budget by $6.1 million, or 27 positions. Last year, they cut $17.8 million, or 139 positions, for a two-year reduction of $23.9 million. This year, they have to cut over half of that again. Now, there are other options that are available to the board, and we've discussed them, which is trying to adopt a budget that will exceed the 60%, but as I mentioned earlier, it's a risky business, because if it gets defeated, then you cannot raise additional taxes. We can put up separate propositions for certain programs, but I don't think we're at that point at this time. So, at this point, Madam President, for your board members, I think you're going to start with the last revised worksheet that I gave during executive session with some revisions in it. It should say revised budget, revised draft up top. I think this is your starting point, and at this point, I'm going to turn it over to you.
I just want to ask a question for a point of clarification. I believe that the board is on consensus, but I would like to verify that it is the board's intention that we're putting out a budget that is under the tax cap.
Yes, I have a question. I just had a question before I vote. What Mr. Priscilla just said about the alternative of having a vote of 60% of the, if it went over the 2%, of having a vote that would have to be passed by 60% of the voters. If a budget was formed and it was put out to the people for the 60% and that was defeated, would then there be a possibility of a second vote for the bare bones budget that would be under the 2%? I mean, is there an alternative? Can a budget be built to say we didn't want to name as many cuts or as many programs to go and ask the voters to do a cast by 60%, and if that's defeated, then go to one that would be the bare bones under?
Well, the boards always have the option to put up a second vote, and that occurs in June. There's a second voting day in June. And when I say that, if it gets defeated twice, some boards choose not to go out for the second option because the new voting requirements is very costly to do such a vote. But it's certainly the board's pleasure to do that. Your first vote, if you were to do that and try it for the 60%, your fallback would, I believe, would try to go then for under the 2.63% or just get the 50% plus one vote. That's certainly the board pleasure. There's different schools of thought on it. Some people say that it's maybe a little bit insulting to put out a second vote if the first one had defeated so long. But again, it's all based on areas and the climate of the voter. The riskiest business that you run into is if that second vote gets defeated. Even if you don't get the 50% plus one, then you are thrust into a budget that's not bare bones. You're thrust into a tax levy that can't go more than a dollar higher. So this year, unlike most years, voters were asked to vote on the budget. This year, they're voting on the levy. So yes, you have that option.
Start on the other side so you can think about that. Mr. Levinstein?
Yes.
Mrs. McAfee?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Mr. Vesely?
Yes.
Ms. Brokaw?
No.
Yes. Okay. So it's the consensus of the board, Mr. Priscilla, to stay under the 2% tax cap.
Under the legal cap.
Under the legal, right. Under the legal cap, which for us is 2.63, actually. So that being said, we have before us recommendations of senior staff, and we still have to find another $2.34 million on top of the recommendations that are before us. So we can either start and go down the alphabetical list that we've been given and discuss those items, or we also are in possession of an alphabetical list of unmandated items where we can look for the other $2.34 million. So, is it the board's pleasure to start with the list of recommendations? Ms. Prokosh?
Yes.
Mr. Vesely?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Mrs. McAfee?
Yes.
Mr. Levinstein?
Yes.
Okay.
Madam
first item that we have for discussion is based upon the recommendation of the special education directors and a review of all IEPs for students, that there be a reduction of 10 one-on-one teaching aides with a dollar value equivalent of $453,089. Open this for discussion. Yes, Ms. Prokop.
Does that mean that the 10 students, the IEPs give that say they do not need teaching aides?
That's the estimate right now after the preliminary reviews of the IEPs that the CSEs, along with the directors of special ed, feel that there's at least 10 students that will not require that next year.
Mr. Levinstein.
Okay, well, I'd like to group first the teaching assistants and the teacher aides both on the Schedule 1. So they're saying that there's 30 children that will be declassified from special ed, the committee?
No, there's 30 children that won't require one-on-one.
That won't require one-on-one. Mm-hmm. That they're going to say that they'll do now and will not come September.
Correct.
Okay, you really haven't declassified that many children over the past few months, so I don't see how that can be, you know, that's can be or in the best interest of the children.
Mr. Swanson, can answer.
Yes, the 10 one-to-one TAs, the teaching aides, are attached to specific children. It's not that we're declassifying those children, we are removing that particular service and support. We are exploring the notion of shared TAs. Our feeling is that for some of these students with disabilities who have a one-to-one TA, a teacher aide, I want to mix up aides and assistants, that some of those students only have a teaching aide for, say, toileting. Our feeling is that a teaching aide could probably help in toileting several students, and not each student would need to have his or her own teaching aide. With regard to the teaching assistants, that's a combination of one-on-ones and classroom teaching assistants. We feel that we are reconfiguring some of our special education programs into models that don't require as heavy a paraprofessional presence.
Yes, Mr. Lewis.
How many teachers, assistants, and teachers aides do we have?
We have 156 teaching assistants, and I'm not sure of the total aides that we have.
And we're talking about cutting 30?
20 teaching assistants, yeah, and 10 aides.
That's 30 that are associated with special education students.
Correct. So we still have 100 of some left.
Mm-hmm. We didn't get to that recommendation yet. Mr. Levinstein.
Mr. Pizzella, these positions, these 30, aren't they basically reimbursed for these positions?
To a certain point, but the following year. But we can't use that against a legal cap. We have to raise funds for them now because they get covered in the following year's revenue.
Well, we're getting paid this year for last year's.
But not nearly the amount. Mr. Swanson can also answer.
Yeah, I think there's been a popular misnomer over the years that a lot of special education services are reimbursed by the federal government, IDEA, when in fact it really comes down to be about $1,200 per student. It's only when we get into high-cost kids where their programs are above, I think the threshold this year was $63,000, those are most of our out-of-district, that we get a substantial reimbursement. But for a typical student receiving services in our school, when you break it all down, it comes out to be about $1,200 per student.
Thank you. So on this item, I apologize, it is the teaching aides, which are 10 positions at $453,089, and 20 teaching assistants associated with special education students at a total of $1,095,846. For that would be a total of reduction of 30 in regards to special education at the recommendation of the Director of Special Education. Are there any other questions on this item? And I will take a consensus on this item. Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Mr. Vesely?
Yes.
Ms. Prokash?
Yes, with the qualification that it doesn't raise any costs as far as what children need.
Of course.
Absolutely. Mr. Levinstein?
No.
Mrs. McAfee?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Yes. The next recommendation is around athletics. There's been much discussion throughout the county that most districts are leaning towards eliminating a level of teams. At this time, it is uncertain what level it is. However, based on projections, the athletic director is confident that we'll be able to participate with the recommended reductions. We have the recommended reduction of athletics modified freshman sports at a cost of $53,500. Questions and comments on this item? Yes, Ms. Prokash.
I was looking over from last year and looking over the teams this year. And last year there were two teams that were brought up that eventually were not talked about. That was the ski team and the ice hockey team. If the ski team and the ice hockey team varsity were cut, that's over $53,000. And then what I had in my mind, my notes was, to keep the modified team because they're used as feeders to varsity team and you're impacting many more students. And we have modified teams in Heritage, South, Metal, Temple, and eventually in, we could have eventually in Gams. You could actually run a modified circuit just among yourselves with two games each and cut down on busing, so on and so forth, but still have skill building for the varsity level. So that's what I would suggest. And also, there's many local parochial schools. They have a parochial school league in Orange County that you can pick up scrimmages with and so forth as far as the 7th and 8th grade team. You will be impacting more students at a less cost. There's two freshman boys teams. I would simply knock it down to one. And the other thing you could save money on would be we have cut some assistant coaches on the varsity level, but there's a few more that probably could be cut without putting anybody in harm's way as far as not having enough coverage. And my other thing would be to also look at the crew team because we do have a crew club in Newburgh that takes in basically the same kids. So that would be my thought would be on those two, keeping the younger ones that would be building up to the varsity level. Otherwise, we talk about being competitive on the varsity level and so on and so forth for kids and some do get scholarships for that. Without a feeder program that is, for many of the kids, especially in the city, that would be no more void for them. So that's what my thoughts on that are.
Other comments? Yes, Mr. Lewis.
I want to ask this, Prokash, are you saying that we would cut some of the assistant coaches?
Well, there's a couple.
From the varsity teams?
Yeah, a couple. But not necessarily ones that would be so they're not able to, for safety reasons. For instance, in swimming, you have three people on deck in swimming. You have a varsity coach, an assistant coach, and a dive coach. You can do that with two. Many schools do it with two. A dive coach and a swim coach. So there is coverage. That's just an example. And let's say with baseball, you might have an assistant coach for baseball. You can do it with one. Different things like that. Different scenarios you can play around with that. But the biggest thing would be the two most expensive, which would be more than $53,000 just for those two teams, rather than cut numerous teams on a lower level.
Yes, Mrs. McAfee.
I would like to speak in support of Ms. Prokosh's proposal. Then, not knowing much about sports, my reason would be that it's obviously a benefit to more students.
Mr. Casella, do you by any chance have the figures with you for those two teams that she mentioned?
Ms. Prokosh, you have last year's cost.
It's around $56,000 just for those two teams. I have that booked in the last year's schedule. It was about that between the team and the...
Yeah, I do. The crew team was $42,700. I'm giving you last year's dollars.
Oh, that's not even the crew.
The crew is $42,682. The ski team was $17,700. And the hockey team was $38,000. And a lot of those, the hockey team is expensive because obviously you have to rent the ice time and the busing.
So the 56 is just for the ski and ice hockey, and that wasn't even considering the crew, and then that could be another 42 on top of that.
Plus you're saving money on busing too, if you went to a smaller schedule with the, you know, with the 7-digit, and you're basically working on skills. That's what you're doing. You're working on the skills, so there, you get the skills to get up to the higher level. And just have almost like an in-house sort of...
And again, affecting less students by doing those teams as opposed to doing it across the board, all modified. Now, what would happen, for argument's sake, what happens if other districts cut those level of sports and then we don't have anyone to compete?
You should play each other. If you have four teams, play each other twice. That's six games right there. Or five, that's eight games. Plus, as I said, you can pick up other ones with programs all around the area because they play. There's several in Orange County. They play, I think it's a 15, 16 game schedule already.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes, I have to agree with this. I agree that we need to take and hinder as few children as possible. And I know for years here in the district that the modified does feed completely into the varsity level. So I totally agree with her at this point.
Other comments on this item? At this point, is it the board's pleasure to look at putting back the modified freshman sports and look at eliminating the ski and ice hockey? And possibly crew, do you want to further discuss that or do you want me to ask that now? Okay. We can separate it.
Right.
We can separate it. Okay. So let me first take consensus on putting the modified and freshman sports back in and eliminating the ski team and the ice hockey team. Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Mr. Vesely?
Yes.
Ms. Prokosh?
Yes.
Mr. Levinstein?
No.
Ms. McAfee?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Yes. Take the crew team separately. Approximate cost an additional $42,000. That was last year's dollars. We do have the Newburgh Rowing Club, and crew is not a sanctioned sport. Although I will speak on behalf of crew, having one of my children participate, I do think it's an awesome opportunity. Mr. Lewis?
Say that again.
We're considering the elimination of the crew team at approximately $42,000. They do have the Newburgh Rowing Club, which allows students to participate in that sport. The district, it's not a state-sanctioned sport, crew, so they could still participate at the rowing club. Of course, there is a cost associated with that, where crew is something that our students get to participate in free of charge that they might not necessarily get to participate in if they could not afford to be a member of a club. So So I see its benefits, but it's also $42,000, so.
Bypass you.
Bypass you? Okay. Mrs. McAfee?
Yes.
Mr. Levinstein?
What do we do?
To eliminate.
No.
Yes.
Mr. Bessley?
Yes.
And Mr. Woodhull, I started with you, right?
No.
No?
No.
Yes.
Four yeses and two noes.
Ms. Rush, would you like to weigh in on this?
I'm kind of lost. I only thought the very last sentence.
All right. There was a suggestion made. We were discussing the recommendation for modified professional sports to be eliminated at a savings of $53,500. So Ms. Prokosh suggested that we eliminate the ski team and the ice hockey team. And the cost of those was actually more than the $53,500. So we took consensus and decided it would also affect less students as far as participation.
Right.
So we took consensus and we currently are scheduled to not have a ski team and an ice hockey team, but to have modified freshman sports. So then up for discussion came the crew team, since that was discussed last year as well. They do have an opportunity to participate in the Newburgh Rowing Club, but I was sharing that there are some students, because of the monetary factor, that might not be able to participate. Because at the school level, even though it's not a sanctioned sport, it is an opportunity for students to participate in that sport free of charge. So I was looking for a consensus on whether we wanted to, at this point, eliminate the crew team or not. And four people have said yes, and two people have said no.
Or a bubble.
I'll say no. We'll just leave that out there. That may come back to the table at a future date, depending on how much more money we're looking for. Our next item on here are attendance aids. It's been determined that the district attendance department will assume the responsibilities from the school. The district will be utilizing a new calling system to replace Connect Ed at a much reduced cost, and a component of this system allows for attendance calling. There will remain the attendance teachers and two attendance aides to still cover home site visits or other visits and other duties as assigned. So the reduction on here of attendance aides is a reduction of attendance aides by 7 at a total savings of $321,000, $321,434. Discussion? Yes, Mr. Lewis.
What is the job of the attendance aides? What do they do? Do they go out and visit, or make home visits, or just make calls, or what?
No, they make calls. Mr. Jensen, Mr. Lewis would like to know the rules and the roles and responsibilities.
We have two attendance teachers in the district that primarily do the
aides.
The aides.
Right. The teachers do the aides are our support back in the school, in the district itself. They do not go out and do the visitations with the teachers. That would require extra spending given to those aides, and that was taken into consideration last year.
So all they do is call.
They do the reports, and they run the reports for the teachers to then do the call on the family themselves. They are supports for the teachers.
Sit in an office and make calls.
They have done that, yes. That's part of our.
Yes. That's okay.
Other questions or comments on this item? Yes, Mr. Vessel.
Maybe Mr. Jensen. When you said there's two attendance teachers in the district, is that for the entire district?
Yes.
Thank you.
Other questions or comments on this item? Yes, Mr. Levinson.
Where are these seven positions? Are they all district, downtown district, or in individual schools?
No, go ahead, Mr.
No, I'm not sure exactly where the...
There are, there's one at each one of the middle schools, and there are several here at Newburgh Free Academy.
Go ahead, Ms. Rush.
So I just want to be certain, the ones that are remaining are going to absorb the two that we're dismissing, it, along with all the new components that we put in place?
We're purchasing a new, like, robocall thing.
Right, right.
And that has an attendance calling feature to it.
Okay.
So many of the calls will be absorbed by that.
Okay.
And just to piggyback on that, the new robo-calling system that we have is a third of the price of the current calling system we have now. So we've even reduced that cost on that calling system.
Existing.
Correct.
Other questions on this item? I will take consensus on the reduction of attendance aids by seven. In the amount of $321,434. Mr. Lewis.
Yes.
Mrs. McAfee.
Yes.
Mr. Levinstein.
No.
Ms. Prokosh.
Yes.
Mr. Vesely.
No.
Mr. Woodhull.
Yes.
Ms. Resch.
Yes.
Yes. Next item is from Buildings and Grounds. It has been determined manageable reductions with the assistance of discussions with the union leaders. By shifting a couple of positions to cover weekends, we can eliminate the need for overtime for building checks. There have been a couple of retirements to minimize the layoffs. The Buildings and Grounds reductions are at five positions, for a total cost of $437,064. Questions and comments on this item? Yes, Mr. Vessel.
How many positions did we eliminate because of attrition from time?
Mr. Wood, I believe it's two, correct? Two.
Two of the five.
Thank you.
Other questions on this item? Yes, Mr. Woodhull.
Yes, I believe you said by the consolidation and using the alternate work week, Andy, we're going to be able to take and get this reduction.
Yes.
Is that built into this?
Are you coming?
We did.
So we discussed in Buildings and Grounds 2 weeks ago.
Other questions or comments on this item? Yes, Mr. Levinstein.
Related to this and other things, when we lay off people, our unemployment insurance really gets bumped up. And correct, Mike?
Mm-hmm.
So any layoffs we have, we're basically a self-insured for unemployment insurance. So I just want that out there. Any layoff today that we make is going to be relatively costly the next year.
We have reserves too.
I understand that, and we've allotted a lot, and it's went up. So the savings that we may get from layoffs, some of that, I think a large figure, is we end up paying back in unemployment.
That's true, but you have reserves to cover that. Your savings you're really not looking for savings. You're looking for ways to get under the legal cap. These salaries go against your legal cap. The unemployment benefits are going to have to pay will come out of your reserves. You can't use those unemployment reserves to cover salary expenses for employees.
Then we're going to put it in next year's budget as a line item to cover.
Unless we have additional fund balance this year to increase the reserves.
Any questions on this item? I'll take consensus on a reduction of 5 full-time positions in the buildings and grounds at a cost of $437,064. Mrs. McAfee?
Yes.
Mr. Levinstein?
No.
Ms. Prokosh?
Yes.
Mr. Vesely?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Ms. Resch?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Yes. Item on our list is, I'm sorry, Mr. Pacella, the bus shuttles. They aren't listed separately on here?
They're not on the memo, no. I was just looking for that.
Okay. All right. So the next item on the revised draft of the budget is bus shuttles from NFA and moving San Miguel to the first or third tier. That would be a savings of $358,000. Do you want to speak to that at all, Mr. Pacella, since we don't have anything here on that?
Yeah, I believe it was the beginning of this year during football, the board decided not to offer the shuttle for the football team. I'm sorry.
On page 4.
Listed number 4. Oh, yeah, I'm sorry. Yeah, this is the other, Madam President, on page 4 of the memo. I can certainly speak to it.
Oh, here it is. Okay. The Board of Ed eliminated the football shuttle this current year, and in keeping with that direction, it's been decided to eliminate all shuttles between campuses. It's been recommended. Also, by changing the start time of a non-public school, which is allowable by law, we can also eliminate buses used during an already busy second tier. This should have no effect on the education of our students. And as I said, that is at a reduction of $358,000. Questions or comments? Yes, Ms. Brokosh.
What are the shuttles used for, like, other than, I mean, during the day, are there students that, for instance, take the subjects here that are not walking here, they have to call them?
No, they're for after school activities.
After school?
Yeah, they're actually very packed. Okay. They're very crowded. Students go back and forth that this campus will offer certain activities. The other campus will also, so there's that constant shuttle back and forth.
Would there be a time, let's say if it was eliminated, would there be a time for the students to be able to get from one campus to the other for the extra activities?
Yeah, I'm sure we can work that out.
And would there be a problem at all with the students cutting up by Union Avenue?
Well, you always have that anyway. Even that was the case with the football team. The football team, when you took away that shuttle, certainly would have to walk past Newburgh Avenue. And that was, I think, part of the reason why we put cameras back there, to secure the safety of those students. So we haven't really gotten that far into how we would work that out, if the fencing would be provided, if it would be a trail. But again, I just kept with the direction that you didn't want the shuttle for football. I just assume that since the football was eliminated, that would be okay to eliminate the other ones.
But you said there's a lot more students involved than they.
Well, even the football shuttle was packed too. they're all, the students do utilize that shuttle for after school.
Other questions on this item? Okay. I'll take consensus on the bus shuttles from NFA and moving San Miguel to first or third tier in North Dome at a reduction of $358,000. Mr. Levinstein?
Yes.
Ms. Prokosh?
Yes.
Mr. Vesely?
Yes.
Mr. Whipple?
I'd like to call him.
Ms. Resch?
I know we're trying not to bubble too many things, but I'm kind of going along with that, just if we can do a little more homework on how these kids would get back and forth. I just don't want more kids out on the street.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Ms. McAfee?
Yes.
Yes. Next item on our list is clerical positions. It calls for a reduction of 8 FTE clerical positions at a savings of $466,074. Our documentation on that is that it's been determined with reduction in other areas, the clerical duties will be absorbed by the remaining clerical staff in addition to a retirement. Discussions on this item? Yes, Mr. Levinstein.
You do schedule 6 first, because schedule 5 is the support for that.
We can always come back to it.
I think that we still feel confident that with those positions, if you choose not to go the route of the other recommendation, they still could be absorbed.
Other questions on this item?
Throughout the whole district.
Throughout the whole district?
Yeah, what would we do? We would restructure the clerical pool, or actually make a clerical pool to be shared amongst administrators. It's a little difficult here at the high school because the high school being so big, they're all not centrally located. But we've been working to see how we can do that even at central office and throughout our buildings on how to pool the clerical staff.
So involve central office as well as the schools?
Well, the whole district. These aren't position specific, they're district wide.
Yes, Mr. Vesely.
Are any of these positions managerial confidential?
The clerical?
Yeah.
No, these are strictly typists.
Okay.
You said one is retiring?
Yes.
Other questions or comments on this item?
I guess just one. One has put their letter of intent to retire in now. CSEA doesn't have the restriction on the February 1st deadline, so there could be more.
Other questions or comments on this item? I'll take consensus on the reduction of clerical staff by 8 positions for savings of $466,074. Ms. Prokosh? Mr. Vesely?
No.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Ms. Resch?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Ms. McAfee?
Yes.
Mr. Levinstein?
No.
Yes. Ms. Prokosh?
I'll be up for it right now.
Item 3. Don't confuse me, Mr. Capella.
Good man.
item calls for a reduction in curriculum directors by number of 7 FTEs at a savings of $1,037,741. We have been provided with an outline on the restructuring of the curriculum and instruction department, and also an outline on how CNI is currently operating and an explanation on how it would operate next year with the reduction of these 7 positions. Questions and comments on this item? Yes, Mr. Levinson.
This is not specific to this item. The process of eliminating people is the third year, and we're eliminating, it's not getting better, and every year it's worse and worse. And I just went to look and see if there's a different way of attacking. All these things affect the children in the class. And I looked at that our proposed line item for health insurance this year is $40 million. I can't see how that needs to be addressed in some way, because like Ms. Prokosh brought up something to maybe do it. How can we have 40 million? That's more than some districts' total budgets. It is an astronomical figure. It's close to 20% of our budget. I think that's something that needs not. Every year we're getting rid of the position, we're taking things away from the kids, and that's my reason.
Do you have some suggestions with a plan to support those suggestions?
I would like that the employees, all the employees from superintendent on down, to participate in the health care costs that we have to save jobs. That's
Those are all good suggestions, but must be negotiated. We did, just so you know, we did bring in the union heads, and we discussed the health insurance. We didn't discuss additional contributions because that's negotiations. We've been advised by council that we can't do that. However, in the contract of all 3 bargaining units, there's language written such that if another plan is substantially equivalent and the union members agree to it, then we can switch. I pointed out that switching over to the Orange Ulster healthcare program, which offers basically the same, there are some differences, obviously it couldn't be exactly the same, we could save $2 million. But that would need the support of all the union, well, the majority of the union members. But until that occurs, the cost is the cost.
I understand we have contracts, but we also have to do them to the children of this district. Not every year to start picking apart and getting less and less people for them in larger classes and all that go along.
All we can do, Mr. Levinstein, is ask. We can't force them.
Yes, Ms. Prokosh.
Is that something that can be asked before the budget is done? I mean, if another, if you're going to be in negotiations, you should run it into, you know, budget or whatever. But we're trying to build a budget, and if we're trying to build a budget on, and I know it's distasteful for all of us because people's jobs are being eliminated. Is there a way to ask legally prior to the budget process being done to see if there's any leeway that we might have, or any way that the bargaining units can help out that way?
Well, that would
rather than having to cut as many things that we're going to have to cut.
We did ask, and unfortunately, it would take a ratification of the union members to vote. It wouldn't be just labor negotiations,
right,
with labor management. Right. It would require the vote which in the teachers' union also includes the retired teachers. Now, this, their health benefits would be affected. So I'm sure then you know how difficult it would be to pass.
I understand that.
So we have asked, and unfortunately, it would take the ratification. And I don't believe, because I've witnessed 20 years worth of negotiations, that's not going to happen within the next 2 months.
Well, what happens if it happens? What happens if it happens? If it happens prior to the beginning of next year, and we say 20, then some of the things could be restored.
You might have that option.
Restored.
Sure, you have that option. Remember, they're not voting on the budget anymore. They're voting on the levy. So, yeah, the board would have that option of reinstating certain programs that were eliminated.
Other questions on this item?
On the directors? Is that what we're on?
Yes.
I'm
going to speak
in
a
while.
No, there's other people speaking.
Yeah. What I thought of with this was CNI doing as much as they're doing and the new APPR coming down and all these other things coming down. I would like to see not all go, but let's say three, whatever you want to call it, you know, grouping. To my mind, I had like humanities and science and the career tech, because of the career tech. One of the things that we're trying to do with our students is not only getting them to go to secondary colleges, but also many students, especially in our area, go to secondary things, a career that not necessarily is a four-year college. And I think you really have to try to increase that over what we have. We have a very good start on it, but I think we would need a director of some sort try. I know they have gone out and gotten some grants and so forth this year, but just try to set up more internships and more things that students then can go from their career academies into apprentice programs and stuff like that. And I think without a director leading the way with that, with everything else going on in the school as far as your academics, I think we'd be shortchanging ourselves, because we basically are high school but also both home. Besides that, I think we need the support staff and someone to lead the way with that. Otherwise, we're going to be really shortchanging ourselves on that. And I can see combining some of the other curriculum directors into a pool, let's say three groups with humanities and a couple, and three with like a science, math, tech type of thing. So I would like to see just to keep three and not eliminate all six or seven of them.
Well, the recommendation is not to eliminate all the directors. There's still, we still will retain three.
That's not where?
If there's 10 total directors in the district.
What three would be kept?
I'm sorry?
What three would be kept?
The special ed director.
Oh,
the
RTI
director. And I'm sorry, the athletic director, and then later on the recommendation.
Yeah, I don't consider that part of this pool, in my opinion.
Well, they're not part of the set.
Right, not part of the set.
Right, there's
right.
Also,
I'm talking about the set. I'm not talking about
right. And also later on, as you get through this, I don't know if you'll get through this tonight, Madam President, but we did recommend the putback of one more.
Yes, which I told you.
Yeah, but sorry.
Because that's when you're talking about the whole volume of things, that would be the least I would want that.
And then there has been a plan to account for all the services that these folks have.
I know, but you okay. Have to agree with that plan. So that's my recommendation, is to keep three out of the seven.
Yes, Mrs. Mentor.
Could I ask Mr. Forget to speak to this, I guess reassurance, Mr. Forget, that this could be done, or what's in your mind? Because our concern often voiced is that we do not want to burn you and your remaining staff out before the job is done. So we're concerned about this.
I appreciate that. One of the things we were asked to do is to try to stay as far away from the classroom as possible. So in doing that, we took a look at what do we have to look like in 3 to 5 years as a result of all the changes that are coming down with the region's reform agenda. Where are we currently at and how are we going to get there? What are the resources that we need, both human and fiscal, to be able to do it in the best interest of the kids? You know, we're talking about them becoming college and career ready, like Ms. Prokosh has just said. In order to do that, we really did stay as far away from the classroom and the schools as possible with our recommendation. That doesn't mean that the roles and responsibilities and the work of the people goes away. The work that they are doing currently is very valuable to the district. I would be remiss if I didn't say I would love to keep every one of them because of the impact that they're having on growing this district. However, in these economic times, we don't have that luxury. So how do we look at the roles and responsibilities and shift them around more at the building level, kind of working with our assistant principals, with the other resources we have at the building and our principals, and myself and Dr. Shanahan becoming much more involved at the building level. So you will see us much more in the schools doing the work and rolling our sleeves up and getting it done. That's the point we're at. We don't have the funding, we don't have the money, but we do have the kids. And those kids are entitled to the most appropriate education we can provide them.
And you're confident that you and Daniel can spearhead this?
I am confident under the fiscal constraints that we have in this school district that we will do the best that we possibly can to meet the requirements of the state education department and, more importantly, the needs of our kids.
Yes, Ms. Prokosh.
And that's why I said keep driven. Because I'm sure Mr. Forge and his staff will try to do and try to get into the building. I know the amount of work that he does now. And I just think it's physical, as much as he's lucky. But I think physically it's going to be impossible to do. And if we have those 3 to 4 work on that to share the load, I think we have to find a way to do that.
Also, part of this 7 includes the additional stipends to the NTA positions for the lead teachers.
Which is something we have to discuss.
To pick up some of the slack. The chairpersons, not the lead teachers. The chairpersons to pick up some of the slack that may be lost.
Any other questions or comments?
Mr.
Yes, Mrs. McAfee.
I think part of our problem, Sue, is that we have difficulty envisioning this because it's a new design.
I understand that, Mrs. McAfee, and I appreciate that as well. And I think if you read the Milltown Record today, you read an article that really said you have to change the paradigm. You have to change. And Mr. Pisa will open the meeting. We have to do more with less. Well, how do you do more with less? How do you do more with less unless you take a look at changing the structure of the organization so that you can accomplish that task with limited resources. And I'm not going to guarantee you that we will do it, but I can tell you that it's a well thought out plan. It includes some of the opportunities for teachers at each level, elementary, middle, and high school, to function as grade and content area curriculum chair people and truly become a content area specialist for each of the levels that they represent. Right now we have K-12 directors. It's very difficult for them to be able to expand between K and 12 to become the content area experts. I believe that the plan is well thought out. I'll say it again. I wish we didn't have to cut the directors. I don't want to cut the directors. But we have to look at curriculum instruction because it is a large portion of the budget in this district and figure out how we can address it. Stay away from the classroom, stay away from the buildings, and keep the support for those kids there.
And this board has tried very hard since you came to us to give you what you said you needed. And I think if Mr. Forgett says that he thinks he can do this, that we should give him the opportunity to try it with a new design.
Just keep in mind that the board has given freely of people and treasure to meet the goals that come down from the state and the unfunded mandates. But we've come to the end of that rope, so to speak. And what I said earlier was we have to wake up to the fact that we have to do less with less. We can no longer continue to put out there the program that we put out 3 or 4 years ago and continue here. Now, every time you bubble something, every time you say we're going to put, I want to put this back or that back, remember, that means we're raising the bar further from that 2.63 that we have to get to. So, I understand what you're saying. Nobody, including me, I know some of you don't believe that, including me, want to see any cuts at all. But the facts are, people sitting out there in that audience don't have the responsibility that the people around this table have. They have the responsibility of making happen the things that we need for the district, and also making happen what the state says we have to do. It's a very difficult thing when you have the responsibility and you have to carry that out. And these people have put untold hours into public service, and this is probably the most difficult thing they have to do. Many of them, including myself, wish we were in a different room right now, a room that we could say to you, we have enough money to do all the programs that we want without cutting anybody. But that's not facing up to reality. That's not facing the responsibilities that the people around this table have. I just want to make that plain, because we're going to be doing this for the next 3 months. So we might as well get to know each other really well. Thank you.
Yes, Mrs. McAfee.
In a way, I'm going to reiterate what you said, in the sense that I agree with you, I agree with Sue, and I agree with Ben.
That's what makes it so difficult.
Exactly. And so it makes it very, very hard to vote. But I think all of us need to keep in mind what Ed was saying about keeping away from the classroom. We're
going to
get to a line soon,
which
does not do that.
Right, and just to reiterate what Mr. Pito said, you're going to get to that line at the end of your, at the end of these recommendations to realize that you're
we're
going
we're still
to
short $2.34 million.
That's correct. Thank you.
But every time you take something out, we're short more than the $2.34. That's what I was trying to say, in a roundabout way.
I just need a point of clarification, Mr. Pacella. On this revised draft, we have a reduction of curriculum directors of 7. But
right.
Then I thought we got some subsequent information. Is it actually a reduction of 6? Or am I?
If you take the February 24th recommendation that we provide, right now, you can certainly review that.
Okay, so right now this is for all 7.
Right now it's for 7.
Okay. That's right.
Yeah, I mean, certainly you can do it any way you'd like. If you want to address the other director that we recommended put back, you can certainly do that. That was in your February 24th.
I think we vote on, or we take consensus on what's here, and then when that item comes up, then it can be discussed then. Are any other questions on the recommendation for the elimination of 7 curriculum directors? This would be a savings of $1,037,741. Mr. Vesely?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Ms. Resch?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Mrs. McAfee?
Yes.
Mr. Levenstein?
No.
Ms. Prokosh?
No. Not on all 7.
Yes. Our next item is under curriculum teachers. We have a proposed reduction of 13 at a savings of $1,220,422. The request of the superintendent directors were to meet with secondary principals to evaluate their respective curriculum areas. And this is the recommendation that came forward from those discussions.
Thirteen classroom teachers.
Page number seven. Mr. Casella, can I see that for you? Go ahead, Ms. Prokosh.
Is this because of the numbers?
Yeah.
The numbers have dropped?
Yeah, it's based on enrollment. Well,
on enrollment?
The numbers, which are the enrollment, did drop. But there is a recommendation of the science, the planetarium, eliminating that actual course. The planetarium needs a lot of work.
Right.
And a lot of repairs. So it was the elimination of that one, and then the numbers on most of them, and then the phase out of some of the language.
Now, phase out of some of the language, I don't understand number 13, that means there'll be no, that language will not be offered at North?
Right, just at this campus. I think that's the recommendation, was to offer it at this campus.
So there's 900 kids going to North, 900 plus, and they would just be offered one language?
Yeah. Mr. Chairman, can you
answer? So if you choose to go to North, to the North campus, and choose, let's say, the forensics or whatever, you would not be allowed to take this language at all?
Over the years,
I thought it was supposed to be equal education at both campuses.
Well, that's when we could afford that.
That was brought up when we got the executive principal. That the reason for having an executive principal was that it would be equal at both campuses. So to say that there's one language that's not going to be offered is not equal, I think.
It certainly limits choice.
Excuse me?
The way it's set up, it certainly limits choice.
Sure it does.
Because if you wanted to take that language, you would have to pick a house in the main campus.
So if you want
to
be a police science, you can't take this language. There should be at least a section open that the child can take. Maybe a teacher has to travel. We've had traveling before.
Mrs. McAfee?
I agree that the language was what bothered me on the sheet, because it does seem to me that there should be a choice. I'm not going to say which of the two languages it should be, but Spanish and something. Mm-hmm. So I'm concerned about that. And if it is an issue of enrollment, then what about having a teacher who would teach half day at our campus and half day at main campus? Maybe something like that. Somebody might be very happy to move campuses in order to have a job. So I agree that I'm concerned as to this.
Yes, Mr. Levinson.
These are just positions, correct, not people?
Correct. Well, there are people in the positions, but yes, it's a position. Yes.
Okay, because they have, I mean, they have salary figures, which may not be correct if it's just a position.
No, the salary figures that I used are correct. I did the seniority bumping. Because otherwise, I couldn't come up with an actual figure. I worked with human resources. I got the seniority list for the teachers and civil service, and I used those salaries. You don't see the names in your packet because that shouldn't influence your decision. So that's why the name has been X'd out of the column, but I do have the name on my computer.
These are positions.
These are positions, correct. But the salaries and their benefits are actual.
Go ahead, Mrs. Maxey.
I'm trying to be a good girl and look at the optimized list of other possible reductions. Yeah, and I'm wondering if my wish would be granted about not eliminating both language extra languages from North Campus, if we could eliminate some Spanish sections from main campus.
Why don't we take a look at the list?
Well, that's on the list.
Well, this
is... Shorten the list and go ahead with the main part of the list.
Oh, okay.
And bubble those.
My board president told me if I wanted to not cut something, I had to come up with something off that list.
Well, I'm glad you're a good trooper and you follow the directions. That's what you're going to tell everybody.
I just made a suggestion to Mr. Pizzo. What if we take consensus on... numbers 1 through 11 on sheet number 7, and we keep the language piece off of that, and then they will re-examine that piece. Is that okay, Ms. Prokosh?
Yes.
Look, yes? Okay. So do we have any other questions or comments before I take consensus on this item? Yes, Ms. Resch.
If the union decided that every teacher wanted to give back a day to keep these teachers, would that be a possibility?
I believe that's negotiations.
But I'm just asking in general.
Well, I get anything with negotiations possible.
Okay. Any other comments on this item? All right, so I'm going to take a consensus on the reduction in curriculum teachers by 11. We will be leaving the language portion of this, which is two positions, on for further discussion at a later time. Mr. Woodhull?
No.
Ms. Resch?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Mrs. McAfee?
Yes.
Mr. Levinstein?
No.
Ms. Prokosh?
Yes.
Mr. Vesely?
No.
Yes. The next item of the list is elementary classroom changes. It calls for a reduction of 6 positions at a savings of $539,705. An exercise of bumping each grade up and evaluating enrollment at grades K-5 resulted in a net reduction of classroom teachers needed for next year. A current scoreboard of our district's enrollment is attached. And also, sheet item number 8 corresponds to this item, labeled elementary classroom changes per scoreboard. Questions and comments on this item? questions or comments on this item? I will take consensus on the reduction of elementary classrooms by 6 positions at a savings of $539,705. Ms. Rush?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Mrs. McAfee?
Yes.
Mr. Levinstein?
Ms. Prokosh?
Yes.
Mr. Vesely?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Yes. Item on the list is elimination of vans to drop off at Children's Corner Nursery. It's a reduction of $134,000. And it's on page 4 of our information sheet. We currently transport K-12 students between Bonville, Fostertown, Meadow Hill, and Temple, and Children's Corner Daycare, which is located on private property in the Kmart Plaza in Valgate. Vans are used for this transportation. Other than special needs transportation, we do not enter private property to pick up or discharge students, even with the permission of the property owner. Discontinuing this practice for Children's Corner would possibly enable us to use these vehicles in outlying areas in place of full-size buses for routes with minimal numbers of students and utilize the full-size buses more efficiently. Yes, Mrs. McAfee.
I don't understand why we were doing it in the first place.
Well, we started this practice because a lot of kindergartners were going there. The Children's Corner Daycare would not send out an adult to receive the kindergarten. So we kept bringing the kindergartner back to the school. It became a problem. The parents created a stir, and Superintendent Saturnelli authorized this to go into there so that we weren't constantly bringing back kindergartners because this organization refused to send someone out or said they couldn't because they didn't have the personnel. We don't have that luxury anymore.
I agree with you.
See, you learn something new.
That we ever had the luxury of doing it.
You learn something new every day, Mrs. McAfee.
Pardon?
You learn something new every day.
Every day. Yeah, my tax dollars are down on my tax. May I go twice?
This was merely put on to give you the heads up when I do stop this. This doesn't stop at this table. You will be getting phone calls, so just to give you a heads up. I have no problem stopping this.
I'll have no problem with those phone calls.
Okay.
Any other questions or comments on this item? Okay. I will take consensus to eliminate the vans dropping off for Children's Corner Nursery at a savings of $134,000. Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Mrs. McAfee?
Yes.
Mr. Levinstein?
Yes.
Yes, yes, yes. Mr. Prokosh? Mrs. Prokosh?
Yes.
Mr. Vesely?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Ms. Resch?
Yes.
Yes. Here's another easy one. Equipment line. Savings of $200,000. Was decided to reduce the overall equipment line an amount that would still leave us enough to cover our contractual obligations. Questions or comments on this item? Okay. Consensus to reduce the equipment lines by $200,000. Mrs. McAfee?
Yes.
Mr. Levinstein?
Yes.
Ms. Prokosh?
Yes.
Mr. Vesely?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Ms. Resch?
Yes.
Mr.
Yes.
Lewis? Yes. Next item on the list is the elimination of the executive director for special education at a savings of $168,910. Questions or comments on this item? Yes, Ms. Gresh.
Could you just explain to us how that's going to be covered? Or Mr. Pizzo?
The department will be covered by the special education director at the secondary level and by the elementary RTI director. And those would be two positions that would manage the responsibilities of the department. In addition to that, we would have responsibility of providing compliance for the department in the department and in collaboration with the curriculum instruction division that would provide educational services and the implementation of services for the students in the collaborative colleges.
Which you've been doing on and off for years anyway, so that kind of falls under you with that?
That's correct. It's a reorganization of the special ed services as we know them. It'll be done in a different way.
I just wanted to make sure I understood the problem.
Other questions or comments on this item? Okay, consensus on the elimination of the executive director special education position at a savings of $168,910. Mrs. McAfee?
Yes.
Mr. Levinstein?
No.
Ms. Prokosh?
Yes.
Mr. Vesely?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Ms. Resch?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Yes. Next item on this list is field trips. On page 4 of our memo, upon recommendation of the directors, it was decided to eliminate the field trip to the Gomez House for Social Studies. And since it's been recommended to eliminate the use of the planetarium, there would be no need to have the elementary schools visit NFA. Other field trips are being analyzed for further review. This is a savings of $12,500.
Questions or comments? But if the PTO is up to raise the money for their class to go to Gomez, that's how they're allowed to get.
Correct. As many of the field trips have become at the buildings, that the district just cannot bear that cost. And so the individual buildings have done fundraisers in order that the students might participate in field trips. Other questions or comments on this item? Yes, Ms. Prokosh.
The planetarium visit to NFA.
Correct.
Not the swimming, but the swimming, that's the planetarium.
That's the planetarium. Okay. Take consensus on the elimination of field trips, the elementary students that are currently going to the planetarium, and the elimination of the Gomez Mill House, which could be funded by private fundraising at the school level. That would be a savings of $12,500. Mr. Levinstein?
Yes.
Ms. Prokosh?
Yes.
Mr. Vesely?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Ms. Resch?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Mrs. McAfee?
Yes.
Yes. The next item on the list is a recommendation to reduce the guidance counselors by one position at a savings of $101,914. The district is in receipt of a retirement letter from one of the current staff. It is determined not to fill the position for next year. So this elimination of this position would be through attrition. Yes, Mrs. Mackey.
In which building? Newburgh Free Academy is the main campus. Just want to point out, even with our new executive principal, I asked about the plan for the use of guidance counselors, and I know Mr. Forget is very involved with them as far as our graduation rate, and now he's going to have to do more with fewer.
Our ratios are much different than most of the other schools in the Hudson Valley, so we're going to lose a guidance counselor through attrition. We felt that was the best interest of everybody at this point.
Just one. That's the only recommendation
as of right now. I mean, if we're going to keep putting things back on, other things have to come off somewhere. So right now, there's one guidance counselor involved.
Through attrition.
Yes, Mrs. Mackey.
And I appreciate that, Mr. Pizzo, but I'm more concerned about the kids than I am about the positions. And I realize that that might be an unpopular thing, but I really want to make sure that we're giving our kids everything that we possibly can, and I know you do too.
Well, then I don't have to answer that.
No, I was just making a comment, an editorial comment.
The point is, I just got the educational meeting. Everybody see this? But you're absolutely correct. I feel bad about every one of these cuts, as I said earlier. But the point is, this one is through attrition. We're going to have to tighten up our belts a little bit in the guidance department and spread those kids out to everyone else. And again, we have to do less with less.
Any other questions or comments on this item? I'll take consensus of the reduction of one guidance counselor at savings of $101,914. Ms. Prokosh? Mr. Vesely?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Ms. Rush?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Mrs. McAfee?
Yes.
Mr. Levinstein?
Yes.
Yes. The next item on this list is homeless liaison, a switch back to civil service 12 month at. Is that a reduction?
That's it. That's an increase because of the grant. And the eventual grant can't keep up with the funding of our salaries and benefits.
So who can speak to this item? I don't see any.
If we kept it in the NPA bargaining unit, it would be a lot more. Right now, the social worker is currently holding that duty as homeless liaison. With that is the teacher's salary. If we went back to the old model where we had a CSEA person doing it, it would be a 12-month at a much cheaper rate and offering full calendar year's worth of service, and it's more in line with what the McKinney-Vento is going to offer as funding. McKinney-Vento grant covers transportation, covers salaries and benefits and other items for homeless children, but that grant funding source is not keeping up with our contracts. So to switch it back into the civil service bargaining unit, we are adding back less than what we would have to add back if we kept it in the other bargaining.
And the homeless liaison position is a state-mandated position?
The title.
It is mandated that a staff member be designated as a homeless liaison, so as long as there is a local liaison, that ultimately.
Mr. Lewis.
So the person who has the job now is homeless. If he goes back to civil service, he has to take a pay cut. Is that right?
If he was the one that was, if he got the job. If he got the job, correct.
But if he doesn't take the job, he doesn't have a job.
Well, you haven't gotten to that portion of the recommendation.
Yes, Mr. Lewis. Mrs. Mack.
So that's going to be addressed, because that was going, I was going to ask about, you know, what are we going to do with an extra, you know, social worker? I'm sure there are many people could think of good, valid things for us to do with an extra social worker, but I can think of things for us to do with that extra guidance counselor, too.
Yep. They're coming up next, or shortly, a few more items.
Yeah, and if you're wondering why these aren't grouped together, because we've been advised by a high-ranking official at New York State School Boards to make this alphabetical, so that it doesn't give the notion that there's any top priority for anyone who's discussing, like it's been said, who wants to discuss. So certainly you've had this list. If you want to address certain items on the list together, that's your option.
It would make it clearer to us, I think, sometimes. Yeah.
Sorry. But it was going pretty well, Mrs. McAfee. okay. So any other questions? Yes, Ms. Prokosh.
I might even take an office. But that means that this homeless liaison would be a position now that CSA and CSEA would be doing. And the person that's currently doing the homeless liaison will be go back into the pool of social workers. Is that what we're saying?
No. We're saying that this position would no longer be done by the social worker.
That's what I'm saying.
But there's no position to go back to. Well, he is certainly welcome to apply for the open homeless liaison position, or he can just accept it in the CSA. This is the only thing, the first year that we've done the homeless liaison with an NTA bargaining unit member, and that was to preserve that position. So that person didn't get unemployed. That's why we did this. Unfortunately, the McKinney Vento now can't pay for that.
I thought just part of it was being paid for. I thought part of that position was being paid for by whatever Vento
did.
Not the whole salary.
The McKinney Vento can no longer cover the health benefits.
Right, but that whatever Vento was paying just for part of that position.
It was paying for, I think it was 95% of that position.
Oh, it was paying for 95%.
Yeah, that's why we structured it so that we could, we switched it over and then we cut back on some other things McKinney Vento was offering so that we can cover that other items. But now with transportation costs rising and other benefits and salaries rising along with the contract, McKinney Vento just doesn't keep up with that. Which is fine. I mean, if this doesn't go through consensus, then we just have to add a little bit more back to cover that person that's currently doing it.
Basically, what we're talking about here is another unfunded mandate. A couple years ago, we had to give up, what was the name of that program from pre-K? The special ed, was it tree, something tree? The Learning Tree program. We had to give up a very nice program that we had funded for many years, because the original funding did not keep up with the salary schedules in the Newburgh district. We had to give it up because our salaries kept outstripping the amount of money that they were giving us to run the program. You recall that we had meetings and many people coming down and hollering at us that we were getting rid of a good program, but we can no longer fund it. And this is, again, unfunded mandates. Or partially funded.
The children that are involved with the homeless liaison will still be getting services, but it will be under the CSEA.
Yeah.
Correct.
And it would be in a salary structure that we can hopefully afford by the time we get to the end of this budget process.
So it won't be affecting them, and this is what they're going to be getting.
No, it will be enhancing them, because now they receive 10 months. This will be a 12-month position.
Okay. Other questions or comments on this item? All right, I will take consensus on the homeless liaison and switching that back to civil service, 12-month position. It will be an addition to the budget of $19,348. Ms. Prokosh?
Yes.
Mr. Vesely?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Ms. Rush?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
No.
Mrs. McAfee?
Yes.
Mr. Levinstein?
Yes.
Yes. Next item on the list is pre-K testing site for a reduction of 3.5 positions at a savings of $445,519. Can someone speak to that?
The pre-K testing site, as you might be aware, has popped up in prior years. We offer, and Mr. Swanson can speak to what they offer, but not many districts have this, and these students that we're required to do, the county is actually responsible. The county can't keep up with certain volumes of what we need to do, so at this point I'll let Mr. Swanson speak as to what the pre-K testing site
involves. Yes, as Mr. Sella indicates, pre-K testing site is not a requirement. It is the obligation of Orange County to evaluate and provide programming for kids, preschoolers who are suspected of having disabilities. The only position that is required for the district would be to have a CTSE, well, a teacher on special assignment who is devoted to CTSE chairperson, and of course the administrative support that would be required. Those costs are covered under the 618 or 619 grant aspect of IDEA. It is a cut to service, but it is not a requirement.
Questions or comments on this item? Consensus on pre-K testing site at a reduction of 3.5 FTE positions for a savings of $445,519. Mr. Vesely?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Ms. Resch?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Ms. McAfee?
Yes.
Mr. Levinstein?
No.
Ms. Prokosh?
Yes.
Yes. The next item on the list calls for a reduction of 3 FTE positions in security at a reduction of $184,161. Based on prior discussions with the Board of Ed, security should not be compromised at the elementary levels. Therefore, it's been recommended to reduce a number of part-time positions and also a few full-time positions at the secondary level. Questions and comments on this item? It does give a listing on sheet number 10 as to the locations for those.
No,
the first two are full-time. Yes, Ms. Fresh.
Do you feel that this student's safety won't be jeopardized?
No. Up here at the secondary?
No.
Well, well, not just secondary.
Well, the two at full, the two full-time are at MFA. Yeah, it just doesn't have a question on it.
Mrs. McAfee?
My concern is that I thought we would have some discussion about no longer having the police officer.
We did not make that. Well, we did not make that recommendation because then we feel it would be compromised. But certainly it's, you have that.
Okay, so I keep the cop.
Yeah, I don't believe that.
If I recall correctly, the board unanimously wanted a cop here tonight with a gun.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
Not to recommend it at this time. Mr. Levinsky.
Your fondness.
If these positions are eliminated, we're not going to the point where now we have to have overtime for existing people to make up for shortages?
Well, they won't be made up for this. We always run into the problem with subs. Subs is a significant cost of extra earnings for security. It has gone down significantly over the past year because we're looking at attendance and actually going forward and being a little more aggressive with making sure that attendance is better. But subs, usually you run that risk when it comes to subs because you don't want to leave certain portions of a school unattended with security. With regards to overtime, certainly it was high school, most of us know, runs like a very medium-sized civic center where it's always open, there's always something going on, and we try to limit the overtime and extra earnings costs whenever possible, but sometimes it's just not possible. With regards to the late buses, the sports that are going on, the community use of the fields, it's very difficult to control something like that, but we try to limit a steady diet of extra earnings because these positions are out. That's not what the intent is.
Have we tried, like some of the other positions, to change schedules?
They are. Yeah, the schedules are staggered during the day because, especially at the high school, you're trying to get 2,600 students in here through metal detectors through limited doors. So we have part-timers come in the morning, and we have a staggered shift and come in a couple hours later to handle the lunch period and then dismissal. So it is staggered up here at the high school. With regards to a Tuesday through Sunday shift or a Saturday through, Saturday through Thursday shift, it really doesn't work because Saturday and Sundays, any type of event going on here is usually a facilities use request, and all of those costs are paid for by the outside agency, so there's no cost to jump.
I would just think evenings because it's always something going on.
Well, we have shift work for evening security at the secondary level. That's currently in place.
Overtime or?
No. That's their shift is pretty much three shift up here.
Take a consensus on the reduction of security by three full-time positions at a savings of $184,161. Mr. Woodhull?
Yes, his one is going to touch the elementary schools.
That's on our other list. Didn't get there yet. Ms. Resch? Mr. Lewis? Mrs. McAfee?
Yes.
Mr. Levinsky?
Yes.
Ms. Prokosh?
Yes.
Mr. Vesely?
Yes.
Yes. The next item on our list is social workers and psychologists with increased DSS assistance. The recommendation is for a reduction of 9 positions, savings of $858,919. These positions have been discussed, removed, and bubbled over the past couple of years. Dr. Noriega has had discussions with the Department of Social Services and has the support of its director, David Jolly, to increase support for the Newburgh and Large City School District. By doing this, we would still be able to offer services to the children at a much reduced cost. On sheet labeled number 11, that gives further explanation of these particular recommendations. Yes, Mr. Lewis.
How many social workers are we cut?
7.
7. And how many is left?
2.
And what will the Orange County Social Service Department do with this?
The Department of Social Services will provide case managers as they did in previous years. They would contract with vendors who would provide staff in the number that we request at a reduced cost. It would be sort of a grant to the district in the sense that the cost that we would end up paying would be about 20% of the total cost, so that we would have the option of requesting from them the number of positions that would be that we would want to. The model ends up having 2 social workers who will be district based, and they will be the coordinators of these services and ensure that the school preventive services that the case managers would provide are in fact being provided to the various schools. The case managers would be co-located in the schools and under the coordination of those 2 social workers. In addition to that, they would provide family services, linkages with the resources existing in the community, and reconnection of services for the children who need those services. We would support that or complement that with the services from the support team staff who would pick up some of the clinical and therapeutic components that the case managers would not be able to provide.
So these kids would not lose any services or the family?
They would
do the same things that our social workers do.
They would not provide therapeutic or counseling services. Those services would be provided by our own support staff, including psychologists or guidance counselors as needed. And the preventive work that the case manager would do would consist of coordination with the community resources, community services, and ensuring that the families are receiving the services that they need, reconnecting services for both families and for students.
So the psychologist will be doing some of that social work, home visits and all that?
No, the psychologist would be providing the clinical, the counseling component that is managed to be.
So this is just for social workers, not for social workers and psychologists.
Like there's a recommendation of a reduction of 2 psychologists. We currently have a total of 15 psychologists. So they're recommending a reduction of 2 psychologists. And we currently have 9 social workers, and the recommendation is for a reduction of 7. So we would have 2 social workers left. So 13 psychologists left for the district and 2 social workers. Are social workers currently doing home visits, Dr. Noriega?
They do home visits as needed.
But
yes,
would they do home visits?
They would be able to do home visits also.
Yes.
Yeah. Connect with resources and connect with community agencies.
So our team is going to work cohesively with their team, so they'll get to know our students like they're already known.
It would be the support team, the support services team that would ensure that those services are being provided to the students.
I'm gathering that there'd be many pre-meetings, so those in place now can turn it over to the new people coming in, and they can get to know the families and the kids' needs and.
We would have to meet with the department and ensure that the services.
I know that it should be done, I just want to hear you say.
Yes, we will.
Other questions? Yes, Mr. Levinstein.
You said there is a charge for this from the county, correct?
Yes.
20%, you said.
The charge is about 20% of the total cost. So that for any case managers provided, we would be paying 20%, which is the model that we followed in the past also. And the NECSD would provide the remaining of this happening.
And no benefits.
Yes. So the 20% would be 20% of the total.
Of the total.
That's because the state and federal and county pick up the other piece. They're required to have these services.
Right.
And through grants that Mr. Jolly writes, he secures the additional funding from those other funds. We met at length today with him just to make sure that what we were bringing to you tonight was correct.
Okay.
So we've done this model before then?
In the past, we have case managers.
And okay, so why did we switch? Was it not working effectively? Why did we go to what we have now?
Because of the cost.
We were able to afford it. This happened back in 2000, I believe.
It was.
But have our students been better served under the current model? I understand the financial aspects, but have our students been better served under the current model than they were when DSS was handling this?
I can't possibly answer that.
I'd say yes, I was here then. Yeah. And I'm the one that mentioned it to you. That we had those people here and it didn't work out. Because we couldn't control that. But it is what it is.
Mr. Levinstein?
And we're not taking 20% off of the money that we're saving. We're taking 20% off, we're paying 20% of their bill, which we have no idea what that might be.
It'll be about, I think today, their total package with salaries that he estimated their salaries are around $40,000 with a 30% increase for benefits. Our cost would roughly be about $12,000 to $15,000.
Yeah, but they need twice as many people. That's
no. No,
so,
our cost would not probably exceed $70,000. That was confirmed today. They currently have, I believe he said, 5,000 cases. So adding the additional 100 or so that we have would not be significant.
Mr. questions or comments on this item? Any suggestions on this item? All right. I'll try to take a consensus on the reduction of 7 social workers and 2 psychologists for a total of 9 FTE positions at a savings of $858,919. Ms. Resch?
Anderson,
All right, let me ask this.
No, I don't have any ideas, I wish I did.
Do we want to separate the social workers and the psychologists?
Okay, that's a start.
All right, we'll do the psychologist first. So I'm looking for a consensus on the recommendation of a reduction of two psychologists. Ms. Resch?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Mrs. McAfee?
Yes.
Mr. Levinstein? Ms. Prokosh?
Yes.
Mr. Vesely?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Yes. That was easy. All right.
Can we do half?
We can do anything we choose to do. Just know that whatever the cost associated, we have to find somewhere else.
Well, we can always come back. Anywhere. I am requesting we do half to begin with.
Three or four.
Kind of where I was going. Four. I'm getting the look.
So. Four. So you want to keep four?
That would be my preference.
So what's that?
Mark has a question.
Yes, Mr.
Levinstein. We're going to double their load, or that half of them service one way and half service the other way?
We would be able to schedule them in a way such that they would be district-based, and they would be able to then address the loads of the various schools and share services between the schools.
But they wouldn't be getting additional help from DSS then?
We could if we wanted to.
I was thinking we were still going to do that. But we still had more of our house people that knew our kids and their needs.
So we had four of our house out of the seven, right? And then additional help from DSS.
Correct. Minus the two psychologists.
You look confused, Mr. Fortune.
Not a good idea?
Trying to figure out where you're going.
There's just a lot of needy kids out there, and I worry.
I
know we all worry about them. I didn't mean that, but personally.
Are you saying to reduce the number of social workers and not to the
No, I'm asking to do both. I would still save the district money, and I feel the kids would be served with that.
Two different systems. I don't know if you want that, though.
In the past, we did that. Right. See, and we could ensure that what Mr. Lewis indicated before doesn't happen. We could ask for the used members of the position to do this. And so,
ask for what? I'm sorry, can you ask for what?
Ask them for a reduced number of positions, meaning if we are going to keep four or five social workers,
right,
then we could request from them an equivalent number of positions,
right,
that could be deployed to provide services.
Okay, that's what I was saying.
Ms. Prokosh?
Maybe we should table this and find out what the different scenarios and the different prices could be, and then discuss it the next time. That would make it now, and we have to see what the different scenarios would be.
The price would be the same. We would just have to know the level that we would have to inform DSS.
Yes, I mean, if we
so,
table it and then find out what, you know, we just think it depends on as what's best for the kids. That's what my suggestion would be. The table it and come back to it.
So let's look at what the cost would be for us to keep four of these seven that are on this list. The cost to keep four of the seven social workers, and then whatever the equivalent we would need from DSS.
Still have a savings.
You want to go to three? I was just putting it out.
To keep four would cost you $467,000. To eliminate three would save you $291,000.
And to keep three?
To eliminate three.
No, I know, but what is it to keep three?
To keep three? $363,620.
And eliminate four, what's the savings on that?
To eliminate four would be $295,376.
Mrs. McAfee.
I always feel miserable when you talk about the social workers, because I would assume that everyone who is here at this table believes it's important to get the kid into the classroom. But once they get in there, there has to be a teacher in that classroom. So if we keep social worker, we're going to be eliminating a teacher or something else. The money has to come from someplace. I'm not sure that that's a benefit. When social services should be provided by society. And now, I'm going to go back to the old teacher in the one-room schoolhouse.
Yeah, I attended that school.
Yeah. And I walked through the school.
I attended.
But maybe, Mrs. McAfee, there's something on this alphabetical list that's not a classroom teacher.
Yeah.
All right, so let's bring this back up for discussion. I'm going to take consensus that we're going to basically bubble this and continue the discussion first. Ms. Resch?
Yes,
bubble. Yes.
Mrs. McAfee?
Yeah, I'm fine. I have a cramp in my leg. All day.
Mr. Levinstein?
Yes.
Ms. Prokosh?
Yes.
Mr. Heskey?
Yes.
Mr. Whipple?
Yes.
Yes. Next item on the list, and I think this will be our last item for this evening because we're going to cut these meetings off at 2 hours, and then we'll set the date for the next budget workshop. So this will be our last item for discussion this evening. Teachers on special assignment. Item has been brought up in the past. See curriculum instruction attachment E, and you'll find the recommendation to reduce the number of these positions throughout the school. Schools. Savings now until it's needed when they get a cohort of seventh graders in there. And this was a reduction of 8 positions at a savings of $690,863. How much would that, no, right, Mr. Cell is doing it right now?
It would be $779,546. Excuse me, I'm sorry. $786,373.
$786?
Yes, $373.
Questions or comments on this item?
How many teachers do we have with special needs?
Do you know that total number in the report? Yeah, because I think we have to look at out of the ones that are left, which ones are mandated, which of those teachers on special assignment are mandated positions, because we do have quite a number of those.
And funded too, some are funded from outside sources too, correct?
Yeah. Yes. Mm-hmm.
Do you have a list of mandated and a list of the funded? Is that what you asked for? I'm sorry.
Well, we want to know the total number of teachers on special assignment. And out of that, which are mandated and which are funded? Consensus on this, or do you want to wait for that information to come in?
I'm thinking,
we'll wait for that information. We're going to set our next meeting. All right, I'll take a consensus on waiting on this item until we have the information that was just requested. Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Mrs. McAfee?
Yes.
Mr. Levinstein?
Yes.
Ms. Prokash? Mr. Vessel?
Yes.
Mr. Newhall?
Yes.
Ms. Rice?
Yes.
Yes. All right. We need to set the date for the next budget workshop.
Madam President, we'd like to know where you stand right now.
Sure.
Your estimated gap right now is $3.2 million.
Estimated gap right now is $3.2 million. How about good news? How much did we, by consensus, agree to reduce the gap by?
Hold on a second.
And on a positive note. Positive in the sense of we have some money, not positive.
$7.1 million.
Nothing's positive because these are positions, and nothing's positive about that. Okay. Let's
then the next finance meeting was scheduled, which is Thursday the 15th. Instead of a finance committee meeting, Mr. Lewis? Instead, the next finance committee meeting is scheduled for Thursday, March 15th. Instead of a finance committee meeting, do you want to do a budget workshop? Okay. So we'll do it. We have health and safety that day, so I'm thinking, well, Mr. Woodhull, can we get health and safety done by, well, what about, could we have health and safety here that day so we could just go into the budget workshop?
We must be going to the family health center on Bridge Street that day.
On a tour.
I won't be back till 6 that day.
All right, so we can do 6 to 8 on Thursday, March 15th.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. I'll be getting over there.
Okay.
Yeah, that'll give us enough time.
Next budget workshop will be Thursday, March 15th, 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. here in this same location. Yes, Mr. Pacell.
If I may, if you have any other suggestions that aren't on any of these lists, because you are now putting this out another week and a half, typically we have the budget, you have it adopted towards the end of March. And certainly, I think we're going to extend this into April because you're going to be getting down to a little much harder decisions. If you can forward me any of those suggestions, I can have them crossed out. Because if you notice on that list, that alphabetical list, some of them don't have crosses because I didn't want to go through the process of the bumping of seniority. If
we didn't want to look at those items.
That's correct. So if you
can, if there's an item on that list, which is labeled D, if there's an item on that list that you want costed out, if you could let Mr. Pacella know, or have other suggestions.
Yes, please.
Okay.
I think Mr. Levinstein probably has a few, since he said no to everything as much as we all wanted to.
Okay. Thank you all very much. Have a good evening.